All right.
Now it's filming.
Yeah.
Cool.
That's a 4 foot 10 inch step. Got trackway all the way through this mud, comes in and out. This is it. We have 4 foot. This is the next step. Foot sideways. Turn your foot around here. I can see almost toes and stuff here. That's a print. 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 And right there's the heel print. Where she put her heel down and not the front of the foot for some reason. So check this out, Bob. What can scoop a palm full of mud out and set it down without anything in between? Not a cow, none of that stuff. There's even marks here from a finger, 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 finger. So it was actually grabbed this direction. You can see the finger marks in this where it was dug out and put right there. Probably is moving forward. And we're looking at depth on a single grab of 4 inches. By 7, so this is probably representative of the hand width.
There's another hole right up there.
Yep, I see.
Yeah, that. I see that.
This could be from the feet, but I don't know how that much mud would have come out of the hole. But I can sure see marks either from fingers or toes. Actually, you know what? Look at this.
Yeah,
I've never seen anything like this. You see this big hole here? You see that divot there,
mm-hmm.
there, there, and
yeah.
there?
Yeah. Wow.
But what's interesting is they don't look like they're connected to the hole. See that?
Hand, quad, running quad. Would your hand leave up
running
mud
quad, yeah. It's pulling mud out of the ground for some reason. And look at this. I would say fingertips.
Mm-hmm.
If I had to guess, right? Just a lot bigger,
yeah.
Of course. But that's what it looks like. Why it's doing this, I'd have no clue, of course. But that's a lot bigger hand than I could make a mark with. And this is, again, a consistent, 7 inches wide? Right at 4 inches deep, or just under 4 inches deep again. So it's obviously a matching mark. Let me go ahead and try to document these.
Wow. That's huge. Some deep holes.
Are you videoing?
Mm-hmm. Look at them all.
So these are the prints yesterday that we saw from the drone and verified here on the ground. And if I could steer your camera for a second, Bob. Thank you. So you see, there's Bob behind the camera. So as we go, this is where it came through over here, and give you a real quick run through, real fast here. You see all this damage on the ground. Okay, so if we go into here, we're going to notice a couple of things in particular. Like this branch was up here on top, see? And it's down and over and down from something pushing, that was bigger, pushing over and down to go through here. And then when we get in here a little deeper, we'll notice this small branch here and the break. What that is, if we move down, we can see where that break happens. This was in the way, and then something lifted it, broke the branch, and pinned it behind another branch. See, that's something that cattle or anything else aren't going to be pulling any of this like this off, not breaking the upright. And then we look down here and we can see where we think that she went quadruped in here and pushing off the front of the feet, a consistent 7-inch width to 8-inch width, and that is consistent with her 19 to 20 inch foot. And you can see here the devastation. Now we've walked all over this. I think a cow came through this morning, but even though we've tracked it up and walked on it, I'm sure you can already see the big prints coming up. What that does show you that the cattle that do make its way through here that don't go through that little tunnel. And then as well, you can see what the size and scale of the disturbance is. I mean, right next to it, that's my footprint right next to this here. And you can see the comparison to the print right next to it. It's almost identical in form. You've got two divots here. So you got a back divot and a sand wedge. Here you got a back divot and a sand wedge. Then you have a four wedge with a sand wrap back in, and we see the same thing. So we can see my foot here. We can get a comparison. My foot in the boot is in this boot is right at 12 inches long in this boot, and as you can see, what happens is we leave a mark, well, 12 inches long. So if we go by what we can see in this formula, and we go to the front of the mark here and the rear of the mark, we're looking at 19 to 20 inches if we scale it off what we know. So obviously this isn't cattle or anything like that. And what happens is she came down here. You see these marks continue. Big ones in the sand here. And you can see that one angle's this way, one angle's that way. And she's getting traction up the sand here. And she actually stepped right here. And we can see, so she's got, there's been a cow again. Cow walked right through this. But she actually stepped here, and this was the top part of her foot before this got deeply pushed in. And this is the swamp location. One of the headwater springs here we can see is coming right out of there. And if you talk about thick. So this is actually where the water's coming from that makes the swamp here. Now reeds, you can see reeds, and when this green's up, this is just going to be a total reed deal, and this goes on around the corner for quite a ways. So anyway, we're gonna try like crazy to find her prints. We've had to deal with cow prints and other things all mixed in the sand here. You can see how deep prints are as well. And I mean, when I push with the same amount of force, 150 pounds in, and I'm barely entering the sand there, and she's got that much surface area. So okay, and we'll cut this. Okay, so we found, you know, on this travel corridor, we came out off the main trackway, and we did so to kind of see where it goes and see if there's not another way in behind this swamp stuff, maybe back with a spring speed. And following what we believe to be the corridor, we re-verified that with these marks here. And what we've got is, if we look, for one, we can see some obvious stuff, but as far back as here, we have the foliage that's been bent over and manipulated. And here, of course, we see what we look for is a snap on a fresh green height of around 8 foot. We've taken some photographs of that. And then we've got another one broke off in here. It's a direct snap as well. And these trees are so difficult to break. They splinter. This is a Russian olive, so it splinters really bad. And all these breaks that we see are just hyper clean from just the amount of pressure you could put on a single branch and break it. And the really neat thing about this one that we can see is we've got a lot of damage here where we've got limbs down, and then it's been split. If you look back in there, let me go. It's been split back here, and this branch has been taken through the others and wrapped around. So there's been quite a manipulation going on with this tree. You can even see some real weird deformation to the branches themselves. And if you look throughout everything, they just don't normally grow that way. So they've been remarking this as a corridor for some time, apparently.
Interesting how the track of the water is still tunneled through the cedars. Standing pools.
Look how much there is.
Wow, look in there.
So you can see the damage. They weren't marking where the cows go, and there was no damage like this at all. Then off that real swampy area we just went through, they marked the corridor in, and now we're cruising through this type of foliage. You can see, if we're not in this semi-clear zone like this, there'd be no way to travel. We haven't been able to find even access through. The rest of it is so thick. But as you can see off of this, there's some tunneled out areas, and we see the damage. It's consistent with their activity. And I'll look down in here. You see the water in there, hopefully. Okay. And you got a lot of these little broke small tunnels where no cows are going through. This is like small hominids use this stuff. And now we're seeing damage consistent with what we recognize as hominid behavior. So, yeah, they're pretty well throughout this little area. We'll grab the materials and we'll just go through and I'll film for a minute as we go. you can see here we got quickset anchoring cement. It's an 8,000 PSI concrete that we use to cast when we're in somewhere like this. We haven't seen any of this, so you see the new fresh damage. I hope you can appreciate how thick it really is. We're in a clear zone that they use for travel, which is why we're seeing all this breakage. Like somewhere most of the cattle avoid. We've seen a bunch of probe marks in the ground like this where they're using sticks to probe for burrows. This is a technique that's not uncommon in Aboriginal cultures, so you can see the reflections of the waters, the backwaters back in here. So this is somewhere they go and people don't. See how much damage is here. None of this is snow damage. We only see this on the travel corridors, that's it. Hey, this had a vocal. Might have been a bird, but it's had a vocal. Sound like a mid to high whistle. So, you see there's water throughout these back areas. Now, cows aren't using this here. But you can see what these tunnels look like. I mean, she might be in here now. We don't really know. And this is winter, and there's still algae in here. And so you can see here, fresh break damage from travel. Same thing here, and then with it, real high over break stuff. So something that would have been up here as an obstruction to a tall animal was broke over and down. We're seeing that just over and over and over, but not anywhere that the cows just use it. So but all these lower zones and wet zones underneath these trees, and everything's basically impenetrable unless you're on these little tunnel sets like what we see here. And we see some coyote running these deals, but we're not seeing a whole lot else. So, but it looks like we're on the other side right there. So, and we've got 50, 80 feet of mud, or at least, just to go back where we came from, and it just kept going. So, maybe we'll just try to paw through this and see we can get out. I know I can see dry ground right there, so here we go. See, here you can see the underzone. This is where these creatures run around. It's not like people are going to be in here. And you can see how hollow that cell is over there, that wet cell. And I'm sure that they don't occupy these long term. They're safe to travel through these things. And here we've got either porcupine or coon tracks here. See, at a precursory examination, I have to look at them a little closer. I would imagine coon. See, really, at any time, we're making a lot of noise, but you can just run right into her, so. Okay, we got a little clearing here. Come on through. See, we're walking on the cleared trails. You can see Bob's not easy to see in there. And these are the clearings. When you get in here where it's thick, you couldn't see Bob 5 feet. So we'll see when these are opened up into these little clean cell zones. And these are the kind of places they'll actually hang out. So, because there's nobody is gonna bother them. See, in any of these.
And you'll notice there's nothing on the ground. Everything's really clean. Even though we look up, all we see is a tangled mess of twigs that are so brittle that if you just touch them, they fall off. So, that's not the flood that washed this out. The ground in most places is still covered, except where they pretty well clean them up when there's no overhang. I don't think we have a lot of choice.
That looks like an open, big open area through there.
Well, it's definitely a passage. It's just not cleared. So, here we go. Let's see here. And, oh, no way. Impenetrable wall. Carrying the Mavic, 10 pounds of concrete, crawling on my knees. You can see what this takes. But you can see this is actually how you get past there. These critters are just so incredibly nimble and agile that smallers can run right through this stuff. But if we look up, the larger branches have been removed. Here, 40 inches, 5 feet. We can see a lot of repeat break, secondary, triple, primary. This comes from an awful lot of travel, and even a big one would go right through there at speed and just not have a problem. You can see passage breaks here as we go by. And we got a break right here. Another open zone. So this is the kind of barriers they'll put between habitation or routes of travel and where they stay. They'll develop incredible barriers. See now, so we see here is this tree's been bent down, right? And we got some breakage up there, but the cool part is down here is what's broken and holding this tree back. Not a lot of animals purposely break a tree and then pin that tree, but break it again so it fits, and then pin that tree behind another tree. This is to purposely close a gap. So as the route of travel into here is more difficult. But all this swamp and all this incredible thick stuff is just to keep kind of provide a barrier or a buffer between the zones they hang out in. So if you're not willing to crawl through this kind of stuff, you're not just going to walk to where they are. See, now this is beautiful in here, and this is in the middle of it all. This is the areas they'd actually hang out and occupy, and you can see the tunnels coming off of it. Here, see, each direction. And we came through a tight marked one. But you'll notice the grass isn't even eaten in here. Probably because there's no cows in here. I don't see some very old horse manures. Billy rode a horse through this. No cow at all. We have no idea where we are. We're just working our way back, actually. This white you see is bromide salt. It tends to crustify the ground quite a bit. What's that? Yeah, more corridor markers. They're all coming in from these side tunnels.
Yeah.
And they're all coming over here, see?
Huh.
So,
I know, yeah, if you could drop down on all four, you could just slide right through this.
Yeah.
And so you just see, keep following the corridor markers, and they'll keep leading you through. Sometimes you don't want to go where they're leading you. See, there's no cow. No cow's reaching up and breaking these down. See, here we go again. A double break. Hey, Bob. Here's a matching double break to that tunnel over there with the big prints. Identical, still hanging from the bark. Like a damn signature. Keep following these. We don't even know where we're going, but we're just following. See, and then you end up with stuff like this. Just laying here. If you look at that, that's part of a kid's toy. Now, why is there part of a kid's toy all the way out here?
And that one.
Laying in the middle of the...
We know they have little kids. And it's on top of...
I take off the river and take home with you.
Yeah, and
the
it's...
Kid can pick up and carry around for the day.
Yeah, big kid would pick that up and carry it around. It's even got a little handle on it.
I wish you'd carry this thing around for a while.
Well, you know, they had two infants since we've been watching. And there's some little chew marks, teething marks on this. Now, wouldn't that be amazing if... And they're on each corner, see? And we're bit right through right there, you can see. Looks like a little hominid bite. Wouldn't that be amazing if this was stolen from one of the houses and brought old George Raymond or something, bring old little one in. Yeah, scavenged. Well, to be sitting where it is, I mean, there's no, you've seen what we took to get in here, there's no people in here, and to be sitting.
I haven't seen any other trash, debris, river trash, or anything.
And this is the next pathway right there.
Mm-hmm.
Right behind us.
Oh, hell yeah.
And that's fresh break right
on that bridge. I don't know. Probably here somewhere. Wouldn't doubt if George or somebody's watching. But yeah, for this to be sitting here is just not, it's just unbelievable. It's on top of the leaf litter. It's definitely, since the flood, something carried it here. Not the flood. So, and I mean, we're talking a flood that was 4 or 5 years ago that swamped everything. And this is on top of the last drop of leaves. So that's pretty amazing. And we know they have little ones. So, and you can see this is friendly to run around in. There's nothing you can get hurt on. The ground's so manicured. Okay, I'm gonna go ahead and move on, I guess. Okay, let me just see this. Let me give you a little panoramic view here. Try to. Let's see here where they can lay up here. Okay, so this is just back to one of their little hidden areas that they can reserve. you talk about what kind of diversity and how protected, and they get back into these places and you can see the damage. And it's not rare when you get back in here and damage at 7 feet, 8 feet, 10 feet. Whole trees laid down. And just look how beautiful this stuff is. It's like walking in feathers. Well, I'm going to look at this bird here. Apparently, somebody got themselves a crow. So it looks like we got a bird consumption site, just feathers. We have a huge, flat, padded. Look at this. Look at this. You know what's interesting here is, see the wood broken from above?
Yeah.
Out of the way? And look how flat, hard, padded from here to here this is. That's really interesting. That's really weird because you wouldn't have, they didn't break off any smaller stuff. It almost looks like two small things put, sit there. And you see, pretty normal for a bird consumption site. All these feathers were probably in a pile at one time and then dispersed. That's how we see, really common. We see it all the time where it's fresh. They've piled the feathers up. And I'm going to take a little loop right here. Just to see, and we'll go right back out and meet them in a minute. Just looking how much travel on the edges of the thick zone. See, we've got, there's water there. So we're going back into swamp water. Heavy damage area here. Look at this. So this is the kind of travel corridors that they're using right here. I'll let this runway take a picture. Let's see if I can focus back in there far enough. Right in front of us here. Alright. See the top damage? Oh, that's actually porcupine there, see? Although something did get a bird right here. So that's tough to say. But you can, now we can see these big, that's what I was kind of looking for. These are feet print. And they're huge. And they go through, they're stepping over this stuff, see. This is not cattle. I mean, a cow couldn't get through that gap without breaking that stick off. And that's one reason that they're, I'm sure, blocking these trails with this stuff. And you see how this one woven in. So they're trying to keep the cows out of here. That's what they're doing. Now we see some high break and high marking. And we'll go out. Well, this is a nice little under tunnel. They're blocking all these though. So just going out.
I've seen all this from the drone, so we can use this. Now we're going to go over here and look. You can look across the top of this stuff. What I saw from the drone was something went up and over this hill, and the cows walked around it. And so I'm looking to see what that was. I actually have some prints. See what these are. This might be just a really overzealous cow that came down here, but it doesn't really look like there's enough knockout for cow. It looks more like a medium hominid on all fours. And over there is the sandbar where we just photographed her prints coming around behind this action. See? Yes, sir. Mm-hmm. I think we could do that. Not in this little backwater. Tracks I saw were coming up over here, so let's see if it's the same set. You can already see some flat padded tracks there that are not cattle. So yeah, there's some stuff here that's not cows, but it sure is knocked out by cows. All these rabbit tracks. No wonder they're out here. My gosh, there's like 8 billion rabbits on this mess. Okay, well, I guess we're going to drop in and go ahead and call this a deal. It's been really, really good success, except we didn't find any prints that were what we would consider castable. I love these erosion holes, huh? Down into nowhere. Yeah, this should be the trail down right next to it. Or somewhere near it. Alright, how about not?
Not. Down there?
I don't know. I'll look. You gotta watch this stuff because you'll collapse through the,
yeah,
the top
holes.
So you can see how deep down it is.
Oh yeah, there's holes in all in.
So this is all too many holes here. It's pretty cliffy.
Wow. I might have to go down a little ways.
Neat spot though.
I know. Go down by the cable.
Areas the coyotes use for dens. So it's the kind of areas that the big hominids dig their coyotes out of their dens. Yeah, cruising these are really dangerous because you can see there's just holes basically all over the place. You could kind of just disappear into them. Here's, well, some hominid made it this way. Yeah, there's juvenile hominid marks right there. You can see it. And no, there's no paw, there's no scuffing, nothing. Huh. The one on the top right's a foot. Then see the three little, the little dots in the dirt at the bottom?
Mm-hmm.
So this is where they go.
This cut back in underneath them?
Probably, it all cuts back. Let's try. It's all hollow, so watch it. Yeah, it goes way under you like a tunnel. I'm looking. Now you got to kind of slide down.
Well, I know. It's right at the base of this hill. It all comes down over here by the river where the cave is.
Yeah, I'll meet you then. I think this is not that bad. I'm going to do it with this and the camera running.
Slide for life.
We're going to do it just the way the other hominid did. Look, I can actually see where he scuffed out earth down here too coming up, but he came up with some a little bit of velocity on the side. Yeah, piece of cake. All right, now if we can get anywhere from here, everything is stabbing me. All right. Yeah, we're out. Where's the easiest? Guess it's this way. Over these guys. Yeah, where would a Bigfoot live that nobody could find it, right? And I mean, we just touched an area, you know, a tiny spot. Just incredible stuff in there. And there's 30 miles of this, miles wide. You could have hundreds of them. All right.